Have you talked directly with Leonard Peltier?
I used to go to Leavenworth 12, 14 years ago. Then one year they had a new chaplain. They said, well, you're not allowed in, you're an ex-con.
How is he doing?
The parole denial really took it out of him, because this parole should have been based upon the length of time he served. You know, you do this much time, you don't have a bad institutional record, and you're not going to be a threat to society when you get out. You're pretty much promised parole. But the parole board came up with all these false denials and denied him, so it really, you know, it took our breath away. You know, it's like we got kicked in the stomach. Mm-hmm. But we had kind of planned for this to come up, but we didn't expect him to pull nothing out of the air. We're just shocked that they think they can actually get away with it.
Does he have access to the internet?
No, he doesn't. And the prison he's kept at in Lewisburg, Pennsylvania, does not allow direct media interviews with its inmates. I think there has to be a phone call made, or have to be put on his phone call list to do a media interview over the telephone, which he has to pay for through his prison account, or money sent to him by his phone card that he makes the outgoing calls.
What about international organizations? Are they supporting, especially human rights advocates?
Yeah, I mean, we have at Amnesty International, we looked at the case, and because Amnesty has their guidelines about getting involved with crimes involving violence, and they looked at it, and after these cases were denied, they went deeper, examined it, and designated him as a political prisoner. They felt all forms of relief, judicial relief, had been exhausted. We've had a number of European parliaments who've joined in, and as I said before, Mikhail Gorbachev, you know, from the Soviet Union, we've had millions and millions of letters come to the United States in support of justice and freedom for Peltier.
And we are the original people, and I consider myself also Native American. We are the original people of this continent, and we're being still treated like delinquents in our own land. Is anyone trying to actually bring justice to our peoples in the current U.S. government?
Well, you know, when we talk about U.S. government, we're talking about politics. And I know from experience, people go into politics, Congress, state legislature, with good intentions, a good heart, but they get in to hit that machine. If they don't play the game of corruption and trade-offs, then they don't accomplish anything. And, you know, we also have, I don't know if it would be called a disease or a handicap, the mentality that they need to fix this. Somebody else needs to take care of this. Well, every time we point fingers, we've got three at us. So this idea about, you know, doing this movement of coalition of all people, I believe we need to take no direction of this. We need to take charge of this. Don't expect them to do this. These government officials here in Washington, D.C. are supposed to be public servants. They're supposed to be accountable to us, but yet we can't even get in their doors. So that is not what we want. What I'm hoping is if we can pull together a mass movement and to show our relatives to the South and North that we are serious, that we're going to take charge, that I hope that we can come back to Washington, D.C. maybe next year, hopefully next year, with at least 1,000 teepees to set up. We want to bring our traditional chiefs, the clan mothers, the elders, the headsmen, not the chiefs that you see today shaking hands with the president. Those so-called chiefs, nothing more but chairman of an organization, because these recognized tribal governments are created through the Bureau of Indian Affairs, 1934 Indian Reorganization Act, 1974 Self-Determination Act. You can be a tribe if you follow these guidelines. Mm-hmm. They don't recognize the true authority that we want.
Is there a national movement of indigenous rights, of Native American rights, in the United States?
Well, there's a number of organizations, but they work on different levels, like the National Congress of American Indians. They're a political lobbying agency, and these are people who like to wear suit and ties and dine in nice restaurants. We've got the American Indian Movement. These are the grassroots organizations. We have an International Indian Treaty Council that they work with the United Nations. And as I say, you know, about, you know, forgetting these racial lines and trying to bring people together, I want to see what, and I'm nobody, but I have this vision. And hopefully, you know, people will listen, and we can get a momentum that we can bring them all together and try to create this unified front.
You've been persecuted also. You've been accused of crimes you didn't commit.
Yes, because I was convicted of a felony in 1978, 1981. And after my release in 1987, actually when I was released in 1988, I was nominated and received the Oklahoma Human Rights Award while I was still incarcerated, which led to my release after serving over 7.5 years, and I did 2.5 more years on parole. Since that time, I have not been involved in any other crimes or illegal activities, and we just believe that this arrest was, you know, a set.
You've been doing this for how long?
28 years.
28 years. And why you do this?
Because, you know, at the time I went to prison, I was a drunk, I was a thief. I was very angry because I was 12 years old, 13, when I realized I'm Indian. This was all over land. Where's my ceremonies? Where's my language? And where's all this, you know, that we used to have? It's all taken. I was angry at white people. And I talked to a friend, went to school in grade school, and I told him, hey, the white people did this, they've done this. But I looked at him, he's white, he's agreeing. So I try not to say white because I want people to hear what I got to say. But if I say white, they get defensive, the wall comes up. So, you know, I tried to use a different language so that they can listen. But when I went to prison in 1981, that's when I first heard about Leonard Peltier through a newspaper article. I subscribed to newsletters from the Peltier Defense Committee. I seen a lot of Leonard's statements, and I thought, you know, I've seen something here. Because every guy goes in prison, they start playing the convict code or being inmates. But here's Leonard, he's not playing that game. He's still being a warrior, he's still being true to himself. He became my role model. And through that, he basically saved my life. So therein is my spiritual commitment to do all I can to get him out.
How do you learn your spiritual knowledge?
I picked up a little bit here and there from different people. I didn't actually make it to my first ceremony until 1978.
Mm-hmm.
Learned a few from other inmates, and I guess it was after I was paroled in 1988 that I got to participate in a lot more Native ceremonies, you know, travel a little bit more whenever I could on while I was on parole. And in 1991, when I completed my parole, we were doing some things in New Mexico for Leonard Peltier. And Chief Billy Tyag here in Maryland, some friends called him, told me after we do our event in South and North Dakota, we're coming to Maryland for a Sundance. And they said, Ben Carnes is with us. I said, great, is he dancing? They asked me, I said, no. He said, well, tell him he's dancing. He should have already been a sun dancer. So I went in, you know, and started sun dancing. On my fourth year, we make a 4-year commitment to do this. On that fourth year, I planned to go and sit on a drum and learn the songs. But something happened that the person who sang the songs couldn't make it that year. So the sun dance chief said, nobody knows the songs like I do, so I got to take care of the drum. So you're leading the dance. And over the years, you know, I was recognized as a Sundance chief. So, you know, I carry that. And this year, I just completed my 19th year of Sundance. I have a Sundance in Colorado, which is 4 years old.
Hmm.
It's fast, you know, like I said, it's a personal prayer between me and the Creator, asking, you know, help me with the opportunity, you know, if you see fit, have the President, you know, call to me and meet with me, because he knows I'm here. You know, people have confused my fast with a hunger strike. Well, if anybody knows Bobby Sands, the Irish Republican Army person who died on hunger strike, if I did hunger strike, I would do it in that same manner. No food, no water, until our demands are met. I came with no demands, just my prayer, and to make myself available as much as possible in that park. But in the meantime, I got to go do radio interviews. I keep my computer here in my style so I can keep my communications in the evenings. Because it's pretty much an individual event, but what I've been doing has captured the ideas of so many people all across the world, that there are so many events taking place in commemoration of Leonard's birthday tomorrow.
And I'm sure your example, it's gonna create an effect. It's a seed that is gonna bring results in the future, especially in generations to come. So thank you for what you do. You've been doing this since September the 5th.
Yeah, September 5th, be a week tomorrow morning at 8:45.
And you finish tomorrow.
Yes, we'll go back to the park and symbolically, you know, we'll bring bread and water. You know, I'll pray over the water, I'll pray over the food, and all those who come to join me to break our fast, because another individual came and joined a few days ago. We'll pray over it, you know, give us all strength, give us clarity, give us guidance, help us to help our people and our children. Then we'll all share this food together.
Absolutely. Thanks.
I want to say that, you know, what we did in 1972, I've been proposing to many of my friends that we do this again, but this time let's don't stick with so-called American Indians, Native Americans. You know, we're citizens of a sovereign nation, our individual nations. If we do these field hearings, we want to include all Indigenous people and invite other nationalities, because I want to eliminate the word race from my vocabulary. I want to just say human race. We all have our own nationalities, we have our ethnicities, our spirituality, but let's find a common ground based upon a consensus-making basis so nobody's left out. We need to come together as one whole movement. And I hope that if I am successful, that we can get that support from South Central America and the rest of this hemisphere so we can help each other in that way.
Mm-hmm. And how can young Americans help in this?
Well, one of the things, you know, I want to say that we all want to be equal, but as I say, you know, we're the caretakers of the land here. This is in our land. We have responsibility. So we would like to take the lead, as I said, in establishing consensus-making basis. Here's why we see this way. This is how we create harmony and unity with the earth, support from the Creator.